I'm going to discuss, as the wonderful moderator explained, the way that anti-Muslim sentiments and human rights discourses, excuse me, go hand in hand in American media discourses. So I'll explain a little bit my theoretical framework for analyzing this, but where I'm coming from, and then at the end I'll show some examples as to what that actually looks like in practice. One of the interesting piece of research come out of the 60s that I think is particularly helpful for analyzing this is what Robert Bella calls civil religion. Civil religion is understood as an elaborate and well-institutionalized form of religion, and it exemplifies the collection of beliefs, symbols, and rituals which are institutionalized. And it serves as a genuine vehicle for national religious self-understanding. So what I'm what I'm trying to use this concept for elaborating on is that human rights discourse, as many other issues, comes as under this umbrella. So the point is that in the United States, as in most other countries, in the UK, this is the same thing. There is some sort of understanding of how religion is supposed to function in public. So for, you know, our UK sort of based audience, it might be something like the poppy appeal for Remembrance Sunday, for example. This is not necessarily a religious thing, but at the same time, something that collectively forms and mobilizes people to act in certain ways. And so human rights functions under this umbrella in the same way, and that's what I'm going to be talking about today. Another thing to bear in mind in this is how news values function in this discussion. So in order to bear this in mind, an event, whatever event that's newsworthy, has to exist, but there have to be multiple ways of looking at the event. If there's only one perspective, it's not newsworthy. You know, it has to be interpreted in multiple ways that makes it newsworthy, similarly related to number one. You know, and most importantly, I think, is that it has to be some deviation, some break from the norms. You know, the question of why do we not have any good news stories? Well, it's not a break from the norms, right? You know, firemen saving, you know, not having a building burned down, that's not really newsworthy because that's their job, right? You know, a fireman saving five people without any protective equipment, you know, on his own, you know, while the building collapses, that's newsworthy because it's not something that happens every day, right? So, so the fact that it's a break from the norms is important. And so, at the same time, news generally refers to the top elite. This is partly to do with their function and status in society, right? You know, the fact that presidents, prime ministers, etc., get interviewed is because they're the leaders of the country. They're supposed to speak to people. The fact that the everyday person isn't interviewed is partly because they're hard to find, because people are busy, have shit to do, and because there's the case of, you know, what are they actually speaking on behalf of? What is their authority? And so as a result, news reports about Islam and Muslims are based on long-standing biases, notions, and definitions. And this is not only the product of sort of white supremacy, you know, has been a topic of discussion, but also just the product of that relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims throughout history, right? That engagement has formed how they relate to one another, whilst inherently still affected by colonialism and white supremacy, as my colleagues have pointed out. At the same time, because of those news values, those biases and notions and definitions get repeated over and over again, because the same people are talking about the same issues in the same way over and over again. And so, thank you. And so, what we find is that what Foucault says is, you know, the authors of texts, right? Media texts are unique in the sense that if I write a newspaper article, that's a unique text. I've produced this. My paper here today is unique. It's, you know, it's here today. It exists for this moment, and I understand it's recorded. You can, you know, view it later, but this is my presentation. If you come back tomorrow, it doesn't exist, right? But at the same time, if you've seen it, or if you come to a lecture later, or as I've done, referred to the papers of my colleagues, right, that their papers have produced mine. They've authored what I'm referring to. And so over time, new stories do this as well. There's a tradition, there's a history that defines how things are perceived over time. And again, if the narrative is repeated over and over and over again, the authoritativeness, the natural ability to understand the story, increases. And so there's a, because of its repetitiveness, it becomes natural and authoritative, and it becomes the only way to perceive things. And so the important thing for me in this research is particularly how, you know, by understanding what emotions and sentiments are expressed in this way. Because if you want to understand, you know, the way that, you know, the positionality of Muslims in American society, in UK society, or any other society, it's important to understand how the world or the context that they live in is named, defined, represented. What are their relationships that are formed? How are they formed? And how is that sphere that they're engaging with defined? And so, as some of my colleagues have pointed out, one of the things I found particularly helpful when it comes to sort of non-Western individuals and societies is what William Kavanagh refers to as the myth of religious violence. And it sets off the idea of non-Western epistemologies, Sanju was talking about, this decolonial thinking, as, you know, irrational, prone to violence, hyper-religious, etc. And by doing so, it sets up a context for Western interventionism, right? So, you know, the if you look at news reports, as I'll bring them out later, as I'll refer to later, you know, when one looks at human rights in this way, and particularly human rights abuses, then by talking about them negatively, particularly in conjunction with religion, religious actors, then that sets up the context for interventionism, and actually precisely the point that because they're making human rights abuses, therefore, you know, Western powers such as the United States should intervene in order to correct that state of affairs. So my first example is this one from Indonesia, for example, in which this refers to a case where the Ahmadi minority were persecuted by a mob that killed three people. And this story is from the New York Times, which I should have put on there, whereby it's mentioned by a lawyer in an institute in Jakarta that, you know, her poor record on human rights might affect the way the case is heard, and negatively in this case. And so, and this raises two important points. One is, you know, the lawyer is speaking from an authority institution. Human Rights Watch is mentioned, as well as, you know, the Community Legal Aid Institute, right? So it highlights that authorities get to speak. This is not just some guy they happen to run into. This is someone that's been selected purposely. At the same time, in this case, right, the human rights angle is highlighted in order to suggest that in this case of trial, true justice is not going to be achieved. Whereby the author of this story sees that this person would be favorable to the murder of those three people belonging to a minority sect because of that, and the two are related. And so the article continues by suggesting that the judge is replaced by a more favorable individual. In this example, it looks at Iranian activists who, again, are seeking to pressure the Iranian government to respect human rights particularly in relationship to the Saudi Arabian government, who this was really published shortly after the Saudi Arabian government allowed women to drive. And so, again, the story, the narrative here is that, you know, in order to progress as a country, you know, it should become a liberal or neoliberal society defined by human rights, which ultimately, you know, expresses itself in ways such as, you know, divorce, you know, abandonment of certain Sharia practices, etc. In no way is there a mention of human rights operating on a meta level, whereby that actually allows for the people in those countries to choose by which way they would want to govern or want to live in those societies. This third story is actually from the Daily Mail, partly to illustrate that this is not solely an American aspect, but also because in this case it is a critique of Western understandings of human rights, but not in the sort of denial of people's human rights, but actually putting it up as, because the, you know, Western societies are so forgiving or accepting of human rights, it means that non-Western people, or in this case an Iraqi drug dealer, can circumvent the rules for deportation because of his human rights. And so it highlights the disparity in which cases human rights is invoked in order to address the narrative that the authors or the text wish to highlight. But in all cases, it is the superiority of the Western context as highlighted as the upholder of human rights that then needs to be equated in the other context. And if that is not done by the people themselves, then it places a context for intervention. And so what we find is that there's a narrative construction that happens. My colleagues mentioned this as well, of a sort of need for progress. And so we can see with the quote from Garnham here that there is a long, clear, lasting relationship between a media message as well as the interpretations that are made. And this is precisely rooted on understandings of Western superiority that is then, whereby in those discussions, human rights is not seen as a freedom to choose for people in other countries or from other backgrounds, but rather as the stick to beat them with, right? It is because you don't invoke human rights in the same way that it might be done in the United States, in Britain, etc., we actually need to intervene in your locale and give it to you, provide it to you, therefore justifying neocolonial practices and interventions around the world. And that's all I had to say. Thank you.